Dennis, so I gotta ask you, what went on the other day in the store with the?
Oh, nothing happened. The one thing, we walked in, me and my lovely wife and my good friend Tonio and all my guys here.
Yeah. It was all you guys over there?
Yeah,
but we walked in. Yeah. And next thing you know, the employee, I guess it's a female, we walked in, and all you saw me do is one thing, this.
Right.
You just stood there.
I just stood there. And I asked him, I said, can we take a couple of gifts for us and stuff like that? And the guy said, yes. I said, okay, great. It's moving a crystal thing.
It was amethyst.
Okay, they asked you to move something?
Yeah, move the crystal.
The people that work there asked you to move the crystal.
Yes.
The owner.
Why weren't they moving it? Why'd they need you?
Oh, hi there, sir. Hi there, bro.
Why did they need your help? They were too small to move?
No. The one thing, I try to help.
Yeah.
I try to help, but guess what I said? As a good person I am, I said, okay, guys, okay, let's go over here and do one thing. And they call it a heist.
Right.
They call it a heist because guess what? That fucking company, I guess they call it yoga or something?
Yeah.
They said, guess what? They're broke.
You think they're trying to shake you down?
Goddamn right.
But wait, did you guys...
Just publicity and shit like that. Exposure, that's what I did, man. But guess what? I don't hate people. I don't hate people, man. You know me.
No, I know that. So you didn't know... Wait, you didn't know that any of this stuff was going to happen?
No, the crystal was going to get broken? Hey, baby, how you doing?
How you?
I love us on style, baby.
Now, listen, Dennis. They're saying that you guys left the store with more than $500 in stolen clothing.
No.
They gave you the clothing.
They gave the clothes, yes. I don't need to steal shit.
Right.
They give me shit.
You're claiming they gifted you that over $500 worth of clothing and items.
Yep.
Well, then how can they get away with then filing the police report? What do you think?
But one thing they say, I guess what, they filed a police report, and then one thing they say, hey, Dennis, guess what? We ain't going to charge you anything because I didn't do anything.
Yeah. I got to ask you, they do say that you and the group reeked of alcohol.
Nate's living room.
I was hoping you were going to give us a little Marilyn Monroe happy birthday to the worm.
Well, that's true, too.
Use your sultry, silky singing voice.
Happy birthday.
Just sticking with the Bulls intro is a better idea.
You.
I said Marilyn Monroe, not Tom Waits.
Happy birthday to you.
What's the date today, man? Have you checked your calendar?
It is the day after my day was robbed by the mothers around the world. It is May 13th.
May 13th. I don't know. Is that known for anything?
It is known these parts? To be the star of Gummo, Jacob Reynolds' birthday.
It's only people who have birthdays the day after yours that you know a lot about, or do you know people who share your birthday as well?
Oh, yeah, I know mine too.
Okay.
Emilio Estevez, Tony Hawk.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah, there's a lot of them. The late, great George Carlin.
That's the 12th, though. The 13th, we're talking that kid from Gummo.
And
the worm, Dennis Rodman, motherfucker.
Baby.
Part of that Chicago second three-peat dynasty.
That's right.
Former member of the New World Order.
Hell yeah.
New York Times best-selling author.
Correct.
North Korean fucking...
Single-handedly.
Yeah, what?
Peace
our
broker.
Envoy over there. He's representing this whole
North
continent.
Korean peace broker.
Is there anything the man hasn't done?
He married Carmen Electra.
Or anyone, yeah.
Yeah, boom. He had a TV show on MTV.
Oh, yeah.
Dennis Rodman World Tour, I think it was called.
Yeah.
Trying to think if there's anything else, man. Yeah, he had a doll. He had all sorts of stuff.
Basically, like one of the biggest legends of sports
entertainment,
of the entertainment world.
Yeah,
just
sports entertainment.
He's woven into the fabric of our culture. This man also a bit of a movie star,
right? cool nickname, Rodzilla.
That's pretty cool, yeah. A lot of people like to lean on that worm nickname, but Rodzilla, very underrated as a nickname.
He had known for dyeing his hair all the time.
That's right.
And he would always step
and
it up.
All of his piercings, many piercings.
He would step it up in the finals. Mm-hmm. And I remember one year he had something Pearl Jam related in his hair.
You got to be kidding me. Eddie Vedder friends? Him and Eddie Vedder hanging out?
I would assume so. I don't think Rodman's just putting anybody in his hair.
That's probably true.
So that's cool.
That's super cool.
You know, he's hanging with Eddie Vedder, smashing Carmen Electra. He's doing it all, man.
Yeah, lately,
Poor kid from Arkansas.
Seems like he's a bit of a drunk. There's a lot of rumors going around.
Did you just hear all of the man's accolades?
That's what I'm saying. The late 90s is definitely a golden age of Dennis Rodman, but I'm asking right now, happy birthday to the man here.
He's 58 years old. Yeah, he's 58 years old today.
I'm just wondering
if a guy wants to tip a few.
Is it time for an intervention? Is it time our pals gather around?
Is it time that you and I step away from it all and take a little break?
Call up Brian Knobs.
Somebody need to tell us that.
Call up.
We need to cool
Cindy
our jets.
Crawford. I know she interviewed him on House of Style.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Get all the Rodman friends together and finally just be like,
"It's like a
you hitting the sauce, brother."
It's like a really dirty version of the Super Friends.
I heard things. But we've done it to ourselves again.
Yeah,
we created a pickle for ourselves.
Uh-huh.
We got this movie podcast going where we talk about action movies.
Yeah.
People aren't telling us what action movies we have to watch, man.
No.
We're picking them ourselves.
Yeah.
And we just keep on picking, like, the most painful things to sit through.
Yeah, well.
You could possibly fucking imagine.
Yeah.
What are we doing?
Like,
Dennis Rodman's birthday, so we're going to watch Double Team? Whose idea was that?
I don't remember. I think it could have been yours. That sounds like it was
this
probably
is just
yours.
A really random idea.
Should we go on with Simon Says?
This fall, the bad boy rocks the big screen.
Incoming!
Hey, baby. Long time no see.
When the enemy strikes.
Did you bring the money?
Do you have the dick?
Simon is the man for the mission.
This is classified U.S. military software.
But when they hit too close to home.
Clear's been kidnapped.
He hit back.
Tell me what's going on before I go Picasso on your ass and rearrange your face.
Now Simon and his team.
Excuse us, major gun battle coming through here.
Are teaching everyone how to play Simon Says.
We are going into battle. We need a theme.
A theme?
Yeah, something to get us pumped.
I know you're a Dane Cook man.
I'm not.
Should we go on with Simon Says?
Anyone has ever seen Simon Says? So that would have been a big question mark. I don't know what I would have been stepping into that way.
Could have been a world premiere then, you know?
Oh yeah, that's true. Could have got the scoop. First people to ever report on Simon Says.
We probably could have gotten Rodman to show up and drink at your house with us.
1999, I think.
Yes.
The millennium was just turning. That was very heady times. Yeah. We're going to give Dennis Rodman a second chance to be a movie star. It's pre-9/11. It was a cocky culture we were living in right there. We're on top of the world. We thought the party would never end.
We can do whatever. You sure we should give Rodman a second movie? That first one he was in did really poorly. Yeah, but that was JCVD's fault, not Dennis Rodman's.
Plus, he's gotten a couple more years to, I don't know, drive that bus around on MTV. I'm just... The man's a name now.
Movie comes out in 99. That's right off the heels of his three-peat there, you know?
It's big times for Chicago.
He wins the finals.
Big times for Dennis Rodman.
And then, bam, immediately, I would assume, is filming. Because I'm assuming they're doing this in the summer of 98. If Simon Says is coming out in 99.
Got to do that off-season filming. That's how it works when you're a fucking dual threat in the world of sports and the world of acting.
Yep. We're not, but you know what? We're not here to talk sports. It's Baby Oil and Blow.
Not this week.
We're talking action extravaganza.
That's right.
Because we're your hosts. Big Time Matt O with me as always. You, sir, are the Scottie Pippen of my Michael Jordan. You are Nate Adams.
Ahoy, ahoy, everybody. I would have preferred to be the Luke Longley to your Horace Grant, but we'll make that work.
Oh, those are different teams, man. Horace Grant was the first three-peat. You would have been like a Bill Wennington. No, I don't think he was even on that team. Who was that? Yeah, we'll get back to that one.
Sure.
But yeah.
I guess.
Luke Longley.
I have a hard time coming up with the names of athletes. I was an indoor kid.
You're the Luke Longley to my Ron Harper.
Okay, I've never heard of that guy. That's fun.
I had his jersey.
His signed or
not?
He had
a stutter.
Probably would have had it signed.
Ron Harper.
You were classy.
Yeah. Good cat. He was in the original NBA Jam.
So we're coming off a long birthday weekend.
Yeah.
A long Mother's Day weekend.
Sure.
I'm feeling like trash.
Yeah.
Just feeling real gross, as per usual. It seems to be our normal Monday story we got going on as we record this podcast.
It turns out you and I don't take very good care of ourselves.
I feel like every week there's especially some sort on the of weekend. New thing happening where it's just like, oh, well, this thing's happening this weekend, so have to make a complete fool of myself.
Right. We don't take care of ourselves in general, but then like on the weekends, it's borderline reckless.
Oh, God. This is like Rodman-esque behavior, I feel like. Yeah. Just like multiple days in a row.
I think
drinking like a 21-year-old.
Yeah, I think if you picked somebody out at random and made them hang with us on a weekend, they might end up in a hospital.
Just like a normal other person in their mid-30s who probably has like a job and a life. A
couple of kids maybe.
They don't just constantly drink like they're 21-year-olds still.
Yeah.
I wonder what that life would be like.
Yeah. Nah, I don't care.
Okay. Let's get into this rundown here.
Hell yeah.
Of our latest ill-considered idea of watching a Dennis Rodman movie to commemorate Dennis Rodman. But nothing more relevant in the world than putting the spotlight on Dennis Rodman.
People have been asking for it.
Ah, Jesus Christ. This week, the rundown's brought to us by Hot Vibes Yoga in Newport Beach. Wait, what do you mean, no? I just got a check from him. Yeah, check from them this morning. They're all paid up. Yeah,
I heard from them. They're going bankrupt. I heard from a very good
source. Very well. Recently had a little bit of a scare where some of their merchandise was pilfered, allegedly.
Allegedly.
A couple days before Dennis Rodman's birthday, Dennis Rodman and his entourage are stealing a 400-pound crystal and $500 worth of clothing from a yoga place. I don't think so, man.
Erroneous.
Los Angeles Times, they're reporting this. This is fake news. This is the lamestream media out there trying to smear my man, the worm.
Hell yeah.
You know what? We're totally up for sale, though, so check cleared. Hot Vibes Yoga, check them out. They got robbed by Dennis Rodman. They're the victims here. go to their studio. Help them out. They're hurting.
Gotta be.
400-pound crystal. I wonder what that looks like.
Amethyst crystal.
I mean,
I've seen them.
Do you think he thought there was something he could smoke? Is that what was going on in his head? Was he just like a little oopsie? He was making a mistake. He didn't really know what that thing was.
You know, I live with a...
When Dennis Rodman stole a 400-pound crystal out of a yoga studio.
I live with a rock hound. I am familiar.
True, yeah.
Familiar with what the amethyst looks like. And yes,
he thought he could smoke it. All right, well, case closed here. This rundown is of 1997's Double Team. This is a movie that had a budget of $30 million, Matt.
Yes, it did.
This is a movie that made a little over $11 million in total.
11 hard-earned.
Everywhere I played.
Yeah.
This was not a success.
This is another movie we're watching. Of the word.
It was not a success.
Again, in any
way that you could define something being 11% on Rotten Tomatoes here.
Did they successfully finish the film?
Did not recoup their budget.
Yes, they did. Mm-hmm. That was a success.
You think that they got all the scenes they needed?
Oh, heavens no. From what I can tell, it's like two movies, but we'll get to that.
Director Hark Sui. He's a Chinese dude. That's why it's a weird thing that I'm not really sure how to pronounce.
Oh, I'm sorry. Was this his English language debut film?
I certainly hope so.
What a success.
Because if he had done any before this and like
so
had
I guess
some reps
you could
in,
say
that'd be embarrassing.
He successfully filmed an English language film.
Yeah, Hong Kong dude. Did a lot of Jet Li movies.
Did you just call him Hong Kong Fooey?
No, I said he's
That's
a Hong
racist.
Kong dude.
You're
he's from the
up.
Hong Kong fucking yeah. film studios. They
Hong
got a
Kong
whole
Fooey's
system
American.
Over there.
Like, yep. That's man.
Either way, I'm not familiar with his other janitor. Work, but I mean,
murder of a
directing
butterfly or
directing
something?
Movies isn't something that like gets lost in translation.
No.
How is this guy doing so many fucking movies? He doesn't know how to put one together. All
right. He's supposedly
Barry
like,
in the lead here,
a big director.
Yeah, what the fuck? The stars of this movie: Jean-Claude Van Damme. He's playing Jack Quinn.
That's a cool action name.
Jack Quinn. Jean-Claude Van Damme was a big action star in the late '80s, early '90s. He started to get a bit of a downswing here.
I'm CIA
this one right here.
Jack Quinn.
Couple before this, Street Fighter, didn't do so hot.
Well, that one was...
There was one more in between Street Fighter and this. Pretty sure that didn't do any... After this, it was straight to video. This was This was the end of Van Damme getting theatrical runs.
I heard he did in Australia.
Oh, good for him.
Like the Legionnaire.
Yeah, that's impressive. Open and wide in Australia.
And Universal Soldier.
Dennis Rodman, the man of the hour. He's playing Yaz, an arms dealer.
One name.
It really just sounds like something that like the girls at that yoga shop would call their vaginas, like a spiritual name. So center your energy on your Yaz.
I've got a good tie it into Chicago sports story about Yaz.
Oh, perfect.
We'll get back to that.
Part-time pro basketball player here in 97, yeah. Full-time attention whore all over the media. They tried to make him a movie star. Didn't quite work out first time. Try it again with Simon Says. Whew, jury's still out on that one. I don't know. We'll see. We'll see if it worked or not. He's 20 years on that now?
Join us.
Ooh, we're getting old.
Join
20-year anniversary of Simon Says.
Join us on the May 13th, 2020 episode of Baby Oil and Blow where we cover Simon Says.
Perfect. This isn't just a big doubleheader, though. We got a triumvirate of cool in this fucking movie. We also got a bad guy.
Hell yeah.
Stavros. He's played by Hollywood actor Mickey Rourke.
Everybody's favorite Greek, Mickey Rourke.
1997 Mickey Rourke's a weird Mickey Rourke because it's like post-meltdown, like not getting work anymore Mickey Rourke, but like...
He's already failed as a boxer.
Like, resurgence as a weird like grizzled oddity old man type thing going on. So we're in a limbo here for Mickey Rourke, but he's looking pretty jacked in this one, brother.
He's jacked to the gills, bro.
They got him on the gas for this one.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with that.
No, he trained extensively in martial arts. That's how he gained his physique.
Sure, he wasn't hanging out with like Hogan and the NWO and Dennis Rodman and they were all just fucking shooting steroids in their assholes.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
Oh, and you are looking live as a limousine the home of the world champion, Chicago Bulls. Tonight is the home of professional wrestling's number one program, Nitro Live. And oh my goodness, that is an NWO limousine. Tony Schiavone, Larry Zbyszko, Mike Bonet.
There they are, the Red Pack.
How are you?
Yeah.
Ticker tape parade, the city of champions. So we.
Hey, it's Denise Rodman.
You know, when I say you call mom, you tell her running, she just pumps up. And that's the beat. You say you call her mom.
There's a tuna.
We. And the pack. What's that?
Dennis Rodman, the world is here.
Tagline.
Where he got the idea for
double
the
team. America's top counter-terrorist usually works alone. This time he's got company. That's cool, man.
That's cool.
That draws
that's
me in right
cool.
there. This guy's a lone wolf, but now he's got to work with somebody?
Oh.
Crazy.
Whoa.
Little plot synopsis. went through
luck.
All the plot synopsis here, and they were all pretty short, which is one way you could do it. I feel like you're trying to synopsize this plot. Either got to go real short or real long.
I was saying,
there's
I
no in between.
I feel like you're leaving a lot off the table there.
An international spy teams up with an arms dealer to escape from a penal colony and rescue his family from a terrorist. That's succinct and to the point. That gets most of it wrapped up there. Yeah, there you go. So that's double team. That's the rundown. You know what we're dealing with. Now we're going to move into bullet points, where we go through our notes and discuss what was going through our minds while we were watching this fucking movie.
Cool.
I want to hear what was swimming around in that beautiful mind of yours as you were sitting down watching Double Team.
Man, it got off the rails pretty quickly.
Okay.
You know?
First impressions, those opening credits.
First impression.
They looked like they were from some sort of like high school AV club presentation. Right. Like real, real classless looking opening credits.
But it was action-y.
They might as well have been in Comic Sans, these opening credits.
But it was action-y.
We did start off right with a big fucking action scene.
Which is, if you're making
like trucks on a mountain and explosions.
If you're making like a late 80s, 90s action movie, I want you to start with action.
Oh, yeah, you got to. It's solid. So, Lethal Weapon always did it that way. They're getting just like jump smash right into some sort of chase or some sort of bomb or something right away. It doesn't even have to necessarily sync up to the rest of the movie. Just give a little action vignette. Start it with, I like that strategy. Start with a little tiny short film, like something blows up and it's huge. Or Jean-Claude Van Damme's driving on a mountain road yelling Stavros a bunch, and bunch of expositions getting thrown at you right and left. And
Stavros!
Within the first 5 minutes,
and
I'm
he also
my head's spinning, and I'm just like, who are these people? What are they doing? Did somebody say something about plutonium?
He's got like a turtleneck and this haircut. He looks like the third Gallagher brother.
I don't know what's going on with JCVD.
Oasis,
look in this
that
movie.
Is. Not, yeah. Not the comedian.
Oh, he doesn't look like Gallagher 3.
No.
He out looks there, wispy, balding hair as he's smashing watermelons.
He looks like he played tambourine on Wonderwall.
He looks like an 8-year-old boy whose mom gives him his haircuts.
Yeah, that too.
But then, like, he looks pretty old, too. Like, I feel like he looks older here than, like, he does 10 years from here.
He's on a lot of cocaine at this
point,
Nate.
I think this was a real rough time for our boy Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Street Fighter was what, 95?
Yeah, thereabouts.
And he was like way into cocaine
just
then.
Just off the fucking rails.
And so like,
oh, that's so cool. He had such a cool 90s.
Clearly at this point, he's just doing movies to get a check to buy cocaine.
Which is weird, because I feel like if you're JCVD and you start showing up at nightclubs and shit, people are going to hand you cocaine.
That's fair.
Like Dennis Rodman getting handed yoga clothes.
Let's get to the point here. The action scene stops, and then they're like, 3 years later, Jack Quinn, he finished his mission.
I don't think we ever got a first name for Stavros,
no, you
so
don't.
He might have been Jack
Stavros.
We're not sure.
Ooh, kindred spirits.
Uh-huh.
So
could have had like a Superman versus Batman Martha moment at the end here, where they realize
you're
they're both
also
named Jack,
Martha? Ooh.
and then they just stop fighting.
Yeah, there's no point to fight anymore. He gets to retire, and he's got a wife in France, and she's pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
And she's good looking.
3 years later, he's got a fucking indoor pool up on a cliff house.
Yeah.
Like, just looking like he's doing pretty good, man.
He looked like he was doing really well.
And his wife's an artist, and her sculptures are shitty. So you know she's not the one bringing in the money.
And the thing I noticed right away was JCVD never has a strong command of the English language.
Oh,
in his
no,
films,
no.
You know?
That's not what brought him to the dance.
Right. But he's especially bad in this one because he's just phoning it in for that cocaine check.
And also, like, his wife is a French
equally
bitch as well. So, like, you got a dude from fucking Belgium, a chick from France, and they're just both trying to stutter their way through the English language.
And
like, why would they be speaking English to each other, Matt?
And then,
clearly,
like,
they both know French.
A CIA buddy of his drops in on them and is like, you're not out, pal. We need you back in.
Mm-hmm.
And it dawned on me, everyone in this movie is talking like Tommy Wiseau.
Hi.
Can I help you?
Yeah, can I have a dozen red roses, please?
Oh, hi, Johnny. I didn't know it was you. Here you go.
That's me. How much is it?
It'll be $18.
Here you go. Keep the change. Hi, doggy.
You're my favorite customer.
Thanks a lot. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Oh, yeah. There's a lot of that going on, for sure.
Like, everyone.
Uh-huh.
It just sounds like
Dennis Rodman, native English speaker, as far as I know, doesn't have a command of any other language. He's having a hard time coming off as a human being. He's having a real hard time registering as a human being when trying to deliver dialogue.
Well, We'll get to him.
Okay.
We'll get to him. But we're
Mickey Rourke, probably the most intelligible person in this film, which is a disgusting thing to think about. Yeah.
He's had his brains scrambled from his awful idea,
sounded
amateur
like
boxing.
A Rhodes scholar compared to the rest of this fucking cast.
I don't know. All I could think was Tommy was...
Also, within like the first 5 minutes of this movie, like you're talking... Old CIA boy comes to try and recruit JCVD back into the game because Stavros is back. JCVD is like, nah, I got this wife and a baby on the way.
I can't do it.
And then in the next scene, Stavros is visiting this recruiter, blows up his car, and then does a badass walking away from the explosion without even flinching as everything just explodes behind him. And I'm just like, hell yeah, Stavros is a badass.
Mm-hmm.
We had that opening chase where he has trying to do something with plutonium.
Mm-hmm.
He got away. They can't handle this guy. He's just indiscriminately blowing up spooks with fucking car bombs.
Yeah.
And then, like, whew, I got to go back to a question I've been asking you through a lot of these movies we've been watching, because things started getting confused for me there for a while. What is Stavros's... What's he doing? What's his plan? What's he trying to accomplish in this movie? What is his criminal scheme?
He's a bad guy.
Yeah, I got that. Just from the way people were talking about him, I was picking that up with context clues. Yeah. Does he have a goal? Does he want to make money? Does he have political aims?
No, it's his career. He's a bad guy. Look, you don't love pizzas. You're not married to pizzas.
Uh-huh.
It's just a job you do.
Sure, yeah.
You cook pizzas. He's a bad guy. That's his career.
At what point does his being a bad lead to... money or
I'm sure it does somewhere.
Is there anything in the you were pretty good last week keeping me on track with what these guys in fucking Stopper My Mom shoot were trying to do with these making these guns disappear. Was there any sort of plan he had? Was there any sort of like machinations that needed to get foiled?
There's a plan that develops, but not till about halfway through. But like for like the beginnings of his crimes, he's just a bad guy.
Okay, and JCVD is a good guy.
Correct.
And they hate each other.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Stavros is a terrorist, as in like not, like, and see, that's the thing in this post 9/11 world where a handful of idiots had a terrible, terrible idea and executed it, and it was for one, what they thought was a greater good, whatever, blah, blah, blah. No. Mickey Rourke, he's just a classic terrorist. You know what that means? He creates terror.
He
just creates terror.
Get out there and spread some terror.
He doesn't think he's going to heaven for a billion virgins or whatever. No. He's a terrorist. Mm-hmm. He's just creating terror.
Yeah.
Mission accomplished.
Yeah.
You know?
Okay.
He's a good guy.
Yeah. So one of my big bullet points, just going along with what you're saying right now, is just what the fuck is the story here? What's happening? Why are these scenes happening in the order that they're happening? Mm. It seems pretty arbitrary. None of these things really seem to sync up as a coherent narrative. What's going on? I feel like I'm having a fever dream. Is any of this real?
I thought the same thing.
Is any of this
some
real?
Point. Wasn't
this
later,
was when I was in the throes of my Mother's Day drunkenness watching this movie.
Oof.
It got so bad. I had to put this on again this morning just to make sure that I wasn't too drunk to follow it.
Wow.
It turns out, in the light of daytime, stone cold sober, it's still fucking unintelligible.
Yeah, it is.
They don't
even
try to make a story.
Apparently, this movie was originally going to be called The Colony.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
In which JCVD is like a thought to be dead, forced to retire CIA agent who gets sent out to this colony with other
CIA agents. So this is another part of the movie that actually happens in this movie. Wasn't quite sure why this happened. At some point, he just gets kidnapped by the CIA and like, you're a prisoner now and you can't escape off this high-tech island. And everyone else who's a prisoner here is also former secret agents.
Catch you up real quick.
And we got like a think tank going on.
Catch you up real quick.
But you're held here against your own will.
He's like, oh, I hate Stavros. And Stavros is like, well, I'm not a big fan of you either. And he's like, all right, I'm going to get Stavros at
the
carnival.
There's a fight at a carnival.
And so Stavros shows
over
up at the carnival.
I don't know.
And they're like, oh, he's got a bomb. There's a woman
meeting
him.
Somehow
she's
they
got
go
a bomb.
From the carnival to a maternity ward. Is that all within the same action sequence? Like,
I think so, yeah.
Like they just stumble out of this carnival and there's like a maternity ward right next to it and then they're just fighting in there.
Because, well, it, okay, so Stavros is at the carnival. They're like, he's meeting with the woman. She's got a bomb. You got to kill him. You got to kill him. And Van Damme's like, no, wait. It's not a bomb. Mm-hmm. And it turns out like it's his son.
Mm-hmm.
Stavros has a kid.
Got a 6-year-old boy or some shit.
And so they
I did pick up on that.
Something happens. They shoot the lady and he's like, oh no. Or he or the tiger lets him know that there's CIA agents.
First appearance of the tiger.
You caught that.
This tiger just shows
Tiger's
up.
Tiger's like, yo, did you see up there? It's a sniper.
Mm-hmm.
And Mickey Rourke shoots the sniper lady in the eye with pinpoint accuracy and then fails.
You said his brain was scrambled from his ill-advised boxing career.
Right after that, though,
the aim on this man.
The one clean shot to her eyeball from like 100 yards.
Yeah, uh-huh.
He then struggles to shoot Van Damme, who's just flailing from a chain link fence.
Well, he's
50 feet in the air.
Floating like a butterfly, man. He's sticking and moving. This guy can move, this Van Damme.
So there's a carnival fight. Stavros' kid accidentally gets killed.
So this is now we've got some grudge involved.
That spills over to a maternity
ward. At first, perhaps
war.
It was just a professional rivalry.
Yeah.
Where one's spreading terror. Yeah.
Like
and
a Tom and a Jerry.
One's a job to try and stop the spread of terror. And maybe they had a begrudging respect even. Yeah. But now that this kid's dead, there's grudge in the air, yeah. Matt. This is personal.
I guess this is more Tom and Jerry now.
Yeah, I guess it was pretty personal between
Those guys
Tom and
had
Jerry.
A lot of grudge.
I don't think it was like a professional misunderstanding between the two of them.
No. Tom hated how Jerry was always making him look bad in front of that housemaid.
Oh, yeah, that is true. It was a little bit of professional jealousy, I guess.
I know you young kids don't know what we're talking about, A, because Tom and Jerry isn't on
anymore.
Probably
think we're just talking about this sweet 70s milkshake cocktail. And I don't even know about the cartoon.
And B, the last time that cartoon was on, they weren't allowed to show the black housemaid anymore because she was...
Oh, is that a thing?
Oh, yeah.
She's a...
Oh.
Screaming caricature?
Oh, yeah. They stopped showing her.
I just figured maybe it's because she was, like, smoking in every scene or something.
No. She was just always like, now, Thomas!
Yeah. I always liked her when I was a kid.
Yeah, she's a good chick. So they fight through the carnival, and that spills over into a maternity ward, and there's, like, explosions and real babies in the scenes.
One of the best things that happens in this movie. There's a lot of hand grenades thrown throughout this movie, which I appreciate. They really utilize hand grenades. So probably the best thing is just Mickey Rourke tosses a hand grenade and Van Damme's got to just run while pushing a like baby carriage with like an infant child in it while there's just explosions behind him. Yeah. And like him and the baby do the typical action hero like jump towards the fucking camera. There's a baby. You've got babies involved.
There's
a lot of
good JCVD jumping from explosions in this movie.
And a lot of just like unnecessary slow motion too.
So I don't know. He gets blown up and goes to the colony, which is its own movie.
Yeah, this is definitely a case where you start at this point seeing just like, I think these were at least two different scripts that got haphazardly mashed together now that we're doing this whole colony prison type thing movie.
Yeah.
Maybe there's a third movie in here that ends at a Roman Colosseum. Cause
also... I think by
nothing
this
about
point,
the third act really syncs up to anything that was going on in the colony.
Before the colony, I want to say they introduced Rodman's character.
First of all, the script of Double Team, the name was Colony.
Agent Quinn achieved clean opportunity to acquire Alpha, but Target Alpha escaped. You went soft, but because of your skills, you've been assigned to the colony.
No!
Great script. And it'd change and change and change.
What's up? What's up?
What's up?
It was a very good movie, but the script changed a lot. It became different. It became more cartoonish.
Who does your hair? Siegfried or Roy?
The last guy made fun of my hair. He's still trying to put his head out of his ass.
It will be a very unusual movie with lots of colors and flavors and the camera move. Very unusual, like MTV, disturbing, but good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a brief scene at the very beginning where he's like,
he goes to a sex
I'm
going to
have
club.
A fight at a carnival, so I need to go to a sex club in like Eastern Europe or something to buy guns, because we don't have any guns in America I can buy.
Yeah, this government team I work for doesn't have their own guns.
No.
So I have to go buy them off of an illegal weapons.
Some sort of crazy haired sex pervert.
Yeah.
And, it tracked to me. Oh, that made sense.
Yeah. So that happened. That was a thing. And then he goes to the colony.
But then, you get a whole second act in the colony with no Rodman.
No.
And then Rodman comes back hard for the third act. It's like all Rodman going on in that third act.
The second act, you don't need to know anything about except for that was originally going to be the movie.
Mm-hmm. And then they were like, hey, now this is a Dennis Rodman starring vehicle, so we've completely changed it.
Yeah.
But this Dennis Rodman movie is only like 45 minutes long, so we're still going to put like half of that colony movie we had written just smushed in the middle here.
Yeah.
And that'll be a thing.
Yeah.
Don't worry. It's all going to come out in the end. It'll be fine.
And the only worthwhile thing of the colony portion of the movie.
I feel like there's a lot of worthwhile stuff going on here.
Is that getting his strength back training montage.
Exactly. Because the baby explosion apparently left Van Damme up on crutches, not feeling so good. Mm-hmm. So then we get a lot of training myself to fucking relearn to use my body. And there's a lot of typical Van Damme doing weird leg stretches and stuff.
It's great.
It's got a lot of weird door jam exercises going on.
Yeah,
there's climbing like a little monkey.
There's no he might be getting better. He's just standing in the doorway one day and it's just like, let me see how high I can kick.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We've all been there.
And he just starts stretching. And then he's like, yeah, you know what? I'm good.
Now I'm going to start filling buckets up with rocks and tearing up my sheets and making pulleys and then using that as a leg lift thing.
And he lifted the tub.
Yeah.
With a yoke.
Okay, so it all climaxed, I think, when he had a yoke built around his old-fashioned claw tub and then just puts his hands behind his back and then just starts fucking hardcore sex video fucking his bathtub.
Yeah.
And screaming. Yeah. There's got to be GIFs of this out there because this is one of the funniest fucking things I've ever seen. Just a from the waist up shot of him just fucking a bathtub.
No, it's a legit workout. If you follow The Rock on Instagram, he's constantly doing just those hip presses, man.
I'm just saying it was very sexual. There's a lot of talk about butt play in this movie, too.
There is. There's
this
a lot of
a very horny movie.
Double entendres.
Horny, horny movie.
See, originally when the movie was called
Rodman's sexual energy creeping in.
Well, originally the movie was called The Colony.
Mm-hmm. It was probably about sex work.
No,
swingers.
Their whole colony was supposed to be off of some islands in Greece.
Ooh,
and so I think
there's
the original
butt stuff going on.
I think
islands.
The original
that's
script
sure.
was going to be related to the country of Greece, and I think that's why they were working a lot of butt double entendre mm-hmm. stuff.
So we're wasting a lot of time in this colony, and then since there's grudge between Stavros and Jack Quinn now, Stavros kidnaps his wife, his pregnant wife, and then is taking care of her at some hotel or something. And then Van Damme finds out through the counterterrorism measures that he's a part of as this think tank in the colony against his own will that this has happened.
Because Stavros is still doing a little terror.
So then he's I got to break out of here to go get my wife and my unborn baby back from Stavros.
Right.
So then we get a big sequence where he plans a high-tech breakout.
Oh,
you
got to also
get past all these water lasers, Matt. You got to have some way that your thumbprint scanner that you have to do every 5 hours or whatever gets thumbprinted.
Don't forget that Stavros knows Jack Quinn's alive, even though everybody else thinks he's dead.
Yes.
And how does he know?
I think because of some vague computer hacking, maybe. There was a throwaway line or something. He's gotten into our signals or
I don't even know.
It was literally just one throwaway line.
Okay.
Unless they just didn't
you
explain it. And I'm conflating
that
with a scene later on where after all this, we're suddenly introduced to computer hacking monks, which
we'll
is like another movie inside of this movie that fucking happens.
That's.
Are we going to get to it? Because my
I don't
head's
know.
Spinning.
You just keep talking.
I'm
really.
Halfway
That's
through
how
this
the movie.
Movie
works.
I'm halfway through this movie.
So he goes back.
My head is spinning.
I was gonna say he goes back to the States. He gets through the laser lake, gets onto a plane, fights people on a plane that might have been good guys. I still don't know what they were dropping off and picking up.
They were
supplies?
The CIA, but they were also holding CIA guys prisoner. There was a plane picking up supplies or dropping off supplies. You don't really know. None of it's explained. Either way, he gets on this plane after cliff diving
and they're
all
like,
this dippy ducking.
They're like, we
cutting
gotta get,
his fingerprint off.
They go, we got to get these supplies back to the shore. And JCVD's like, supplies. I like this line, though, when he's like, do you have a parachute? And the guy's like,
yeah.
Yeah. And he's like,
he kicks him right out of the fucking plane, man.
And kicks him out of the plane.
Fucking roundhouse kicks him. The guy goes flying right out of that plane.
Do you have a parachute? That's my JCVD. And then he...
Then he hooks back up with Dennis Rodman. And he's like, yo, Yaz, we got to go after Stavros, man. Yeah. I need those guns again. You're the only person in the world who sells guns.
Right.
What am I going to do if you don't sell me guns?
He's like, I don't sell guns without money, son. And then JCVD's like... I have the three different CIA bank accounts. If
and
you
is
give me...
that when they go visit the computer hacking monks who live under
know.
A church?
We're getting there. What do I got? Let me look at my notes here. I'm playing loose. They jump out of a plane without a parachute, but Rodman's built a basketball that opens up around them, and they safely land in. That's
they
not
don't
made
even
up.
Attempt for a second to explain what this thing is, how it would work. It's just like, oh no,
Rodman
I got
just
this
keeps
thing.
Saying, of course it works.
And then a cut.
I built it.
And then a cut to this big basketball they're inside of, just landing on the ground gingerly after they jumped out of a plane. It's just like, oh yeah, it did work, I guess. And for some reason, they didn't reach terminal velocity because they were inside of a big basketball.
Yeah. And then, JCVD dresses up like Robert Smith from The Cure.
Okay, here's where they're going undercover.
And there's
Dennis
a wedding.
Rodman's wearing a lot of like linens and like fedoras. They're JCVD is dressed up like a fucking gutter punk. He's got like a nose ring in and like a Captain Caveman vest and a goofy curly wig, and he looks great.
Yeah.
And this is what I'm just realizing, like, this movie's just made by a bunch of middle-aged men who have no idea.
No.
What's hip or cool out there in the world right now?
Like,
they're just taking stabs in the dark.
Rodman's dressed like a perverted weirdo the whole movie.
Mm-hmm.
And then
suddenly
they just
suddenly
shift.
He's Belloc from Indiana Jones out
like,
of nowhere.
Yeah. Like, you know, you'd look cool dressed like Dick Tracy.
Yeah, and it's like, also, I'm not even going to like just sell you these guns in exchange for these CIA bank accounts. Now we're just partners, and I'm going to fight Stavros with you.
Yeah.
Even though I've got nothing to do with this fight. Yeah. I don't know who Stavros is. There's no reason for me to be doing this. We got ourselves a double team, man.
Yeah.
Finally.
Right.
Deep into the third act, we've got a double team.
Well, because, like, he finds out, this is the scene where he finds out, like, oh, he's got the pregnant wife, and, like, Dennis Rodman's like, they took your kid?
Mm-hmm.
Bro, you should have just told me that.
Okay,
you know I wouldn't have charged you for that.
Oh, so he turns out he's a really good guy.
Yeah.
So he just...
Because he's always cared about Jack and his family.
Jack Quinn,
his one-day family, as we've clearly established earlier.
So they try to double-team and get the wife back, which succeeds. But then they realize that the baby has already been born, and Mickey Rourke has the baby.
Mm-hmm.
So now they need to go get the baby. And that's when the big, crazy finale happens in the middle of some sort of Roman Colosseum ruins. And... oh boy, what the fuck is this third act? Well, I was saying, Mickey Rourke seems to have no plan at any point in the movie. His plan here is fucking crazy.
Yeah. Tiger fight in a minefield.
He's got his tiger back. He's created a minefield in the middle of this Colosseum, but he's marked all of the mines, weirdly, with crosses over them. So it's not much of a minefield. You're telling us where all the mines are. And then he's just got the baby. And it's just like, here's my plan. Chaos. Tiger, newborn, mines, my shirt's off, let's have at it. And then the whole third act is just fights happening in this location.
Rodman takes his shirt off. No one's wearing a shirt by the end of this
no
movie.
No shirts. Rodman's around, going around on a fucking like little dirt bike.
Oh, also, inexplicably, at some point, one of the other guys from the colony got off the colony, and he's there to make sure that they're playing the game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I didn't get how he came back at the end.
No.
One thing I skipped over that I feel like we need to address, which is my favorite part of the movie, was when they were getting the wife back, they were in the hotel she was holed up in.
Yeah.
And JCVD had to fight the goon who fought him by holding a switchblade between his toes
and kicking
a bunch with a switchblade held between his monkey toes in this fight that went on for like 5 minutes, because clearly somebody thought this was the coolest idea they had ever. Just put the switchblade in your hand, man.
He's spending like 5 minutes trying to
catch... Why are you barefoot?
He's spending 5 minutes trying to catch this guy that was like a sniper and then had like a cool machine gun guitar case like El Mariachi. Mm. And it's like...
Not quite that cool.
But it was along those lines. It's like, oh, that's always appreciated. Everybody likes that kind of shit.
Mm-hmm.
And then like inexplicably, while chasing the gun guy, they just transitioned to this other guy.
Mm-hmm. He's got a knife between his toes.
And then like gun guy ends
this
up...
This is like some Quentin Tarantino foot fetish shit going on here.
I don't
here.
Know.
What the hell was going on in
gun
this
guy
scene?
Ends
weird.
Up lazily getting killed because this guy exists. It was really weird. It was really weird.
But the finale, there's mines everywhere. Jean-Claude Van Damme literally has to fight, hand-to-hand fight a tiger.
Yep.
Dennis Rodman's
he
riding
kicks
his
a
dirt
tiger.
Bike around with the newborn baby just in a basket
there's
on his
a,
dirt bike.
There is a scene where he kicks the tiger in the head.
Absolutely. Then he has to fight Mickey Rourke. Everybody's stepping on landmines. Explosions are going off. Things
Rodman
are triggered.
Hides a baby in a hole... In a thousands-year-old building.
Mm, yeah, just tucks down in this little in crevice. It's like a biblical story, I feel like. Babies
goes,
were constantly getting hidden in the Bible.
To which he says, don't you party without me.
That's a pretty cool line.
Yeah, it's
maybe
cool.
The one line that he says in the whole movie that's not
basketball.
A basketball yeah. pun of some yeah. kind. So this character is like just like an androgynous weapons dealer.
Right.
He's not a pro athlete.
No.
So we're given no reason why all he talks about is basketball.
There's not even... I think there might have been like one line where they like talk about how tall he is.
There's a lot of air ball.
Yeah.
There's a lot of talk about how best defense is okay. playing offense.
Yeah.
A lot of quips about how he doesn't like going to practice. Which
yep.
is, yeah, he was skipping out on a lot of practices from what I remember.
Yeah.
Hitting the sauce back in the 90s too much even probably.
Yeah. What are you going to do?
Come on, Rodzilla. Get your life together. We all care about you so much.
You're still killing it.
Me, Brian Knobs, Cindy still Crawford, we all came here to tell you that we love you.
Karl Malone and DDP drove in on their 18-wheeler just to tell you they care.
Finally, the big climactic awesome fucking scene, maybe like the third of the three cool things that happened in this, is when Mickey Rourke steps on one of his own landmines because Dennis Rodman moved the markers around because
yeah,
he's a genius. The tiger's coming back at him again with fucking Jack Quinn and Yaz. They peace out. So
yeah.
Mickey Rourke's left there standing on his own landmine with his own fucking tiger buddy coming after him.
And he cries.
And he cries and he realizes that it's over. He's not going to spread any more terror. Jack Quinn and the CIA have won.
Yeah.
We're not sure if Jack Quinn and the CIA are still on the same page yet because
well,
they did keep him locked up on an island for a long time.
At the very beginning of the movie, they established, they gave Jack Quinn 6 orders.
Mm-hmm.
And the fourth one was, you need to bring in Stavros alive.
Yeah.
And then the 6th order was, this doesn't end until Stavros is dead.
Some conflicting orders. Fuck, I can see he was as confused as I was.
Yeah.
Well, then Rourke just lifts his foot up, and then Mickey Rourke and a CGI tiger both just explode.
It was the real. It was the real Mickey Rourke, though, right?
Yeah.
And not
no,
a CGI
no.
Mickey Rourke.
They had to use a puppet for some scenes after
okay.
he stopped showing up to set, but
yeah.
never any CG for any of their Mickey Rourke effects.
Yeah. He really got blown up.
Mickey Rourke
end.
And a tiger explode. That's the end of the fucking movie.
Now, but hold on. It's not just one mine. It's a minefield, so it's a huge explosion.
Oh, yeah. There's fireballs everywhere.
Yaz and Jack Quinn and the other guy that showed up for no reason.
Yes.
And the baby.
CIA island guy.
They still got to get out of there.
Mm-hmm.
They're not quite out of there. How are they going to survive that bomb explosion, Nate?
You cut jump cut to them being outside of it and everything's okay?
No.
This is not what happened?
No.
What happened?
There was those classic Coke vending machines inside of the Coliseum.
Oh, yeah, I forgot.
That
there was Coke all throughout this movie. Coke spent a pretty penny on this fucking movie.
Yeah, they really did. And they used a Coke machine.
Mm-hmm.
Dennis Rodman saves the day. He's like, I'm going to take one of these 12 Coke machines that's in these ancient ruins and block the fire.
Sure.
And they lived.
Well, it's refrigerated, you know. That fire's not getting through those...
And
icy cans of Coke. This is a great plan.
And then they're like, well.
Then it's jump cut to them all just standing around outside of it while the entire place burns behind them.
They're like, well, that's it. We're done. And then Island Guy's like, or is it?
Mm-hmm.
Cut your hair and your shirt. I'm going to kill you, JCVD. And then Dennis Rodman.
I did not get what the whole cut some of your hair and your shirt thing was.
So he could prove that it was him and he killed him. He had his DNA. So
he was going to kill him.
He was
going
to kill him, yeah.
Well, then seconds later, him and Dennis Rodman are just laughing and elbowing each other and getting in a car together.
Because Dennis Rodman got him. He's like, maybe instead of the coin and hair, he'd like my lucky coin. Smoke bomb!
Yeah, because apparently he's also a magician on the side a little bit.
And then the guy was like...
In all the confusion of the Dennis Rodman smoke bomb, JCVD drives away
with the kid. And then guy turns to Dennis Rodman and goes, you sure got the best of me.
Yeah, hey, remember when you were going to kill my friend 20 seconds ago? Well, it's all cool, man. Don't party without me.
Yeah, and then that guy just leaves, and then it's just Dennis Rodman looking at the burning Coliseum.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And he goes, oh, man, you know they're going to blame me for this one.
Yeah,
I wonder what the fine's going to be.
Yeah. And then it's like, oh, because spinoff movie, we're going to get the continued adventures of Yaz. This shit is always happening to Yaz, I bet.
No, it's because he was getting kicked out of games all the time and getting fined left and right. It was a joke about that.
So you're still not wanting to see those Adventures of Yaz series that
Chronicles?
I've been trying to get you to read my...
Yeah.
The continued Adventures of Yaz
your
stories.
Fan fiction
you keep trying to just blow it off.
Yeah, no, I want to read that. And then it jumps straight from that to Just a Freak by Crystal Waters featuring Dennis Rodman.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't even notice that Rodman was on the track. I was just thinking about how lame that music sounded for 1997.
Yeah, she's like singing whatever, and then it cuts to him, and he's like, she got the family jewels between her legs.
Oh, Christ. Terrible script. The dialogue's miserable. The people who are trying to deliver the dialogue, most of them can't speak English good. The story makes no sense.
Good Lee, uneducated asshole.
That'd be fine if we could just have a bunch of crazy fucking over-the-top action in this thing, and you didn't have to think about it. But the biggest problem with this movie, man, one of my main bullet points, is that the action is so poorly put together in this movie. I don't understand how this guy's a big Hong Kong action film director. It's just shot terribly. Just weird Dutch angles and extreme close-ups. There's no fight choreography. There's no impressive stunts. Everything's just edited within an inch of its life.
They brought
somebody
in. So you
can't see that nothing's really
specifically
happening.
Specifically for the fight choreography.
That guy must have been so sad when he saw the film and realized that none of what he put together made the end of the film, because it's just one cut every 2 seconds, the 180 degree rule out the fucking window. We're shooting from this side of a fucking stage. We're shooting from that side of the stage. You never know where you are at any fucking moment. It's just big stupid mess. This is how all fucking action films started looking in the early 2000s, when all of our great action directors like John McTiernan started going to jail for bullshit tax reasons or whatever.
Sammo Kambo Hung was brought in as special action choreographer.
Sammo Kambo Bo Hung. They massacred your boy. Whatever choreography you were doing. There's like maybe 20 seconds of Dennis Rodman fighting where he's doing some throwback tall basketball player karate shit from like fucking, what was that, Enter the Dragon or whatever?
Yeah. Maybe
like 20 seconds.
Some of his fighting made sense.
Maybe like 20 seconds.
Because it had like a theme.
Also, he could just like pick guys up and just like throw them through the air like grown men. He had the super strength of a Marvel's Avenger out of nowhere.
Physics kind of went out the window on this
out
one.
Out the fucking window. Yeah. The action sucked. The script sucked. A couple what the fuck things that I liked. Just him jumping away from explosions with babies.
Yeah.
The switchblade between the toes.
Yeah.
They're just little brief moments. That's all you had. Yeah. That's all you fucking had.
I thought Dennis Rodman was likable.
You thought Dennis Rodman was likable?
Yeah.
I thought he was extremely unlikable. just constant mugging for the camera.
Yeah. That's okay.
Clearly just reading cue cards. Yeah. Like, very clearly, just like awkwardly just reading things in front of him because he could not be bothered to memorize more than one line at a time. Does not sound like a human being when he talks. Sounds like some sort of alien robot.
I thought he did a better job than Jordan in Space Jam.
I haven't seen Space Jam since I was a kid. I remember Jordan being pretty bad in Space Jam. Has there any ever been an NBA player to make a successful jump to the acting world?
Yeah, Charles Barkley. He was good in Space Jam.
Did you get any post-Space Jam work, or are we all just talking Space Jam?
He was recently in an episode of Modern Family.
Oh, good for him. Yeah, we'll call Charles Barkley the big acting success of the NBA.
Tell you what, I'll think about it more. There's got to be other ones.
Underwater lasers, basketball parachutes. They just sounded like...
It wasn't a parachute. It was just a cloth basketball that dropped them to
like
safety.
It sounded like a bunch of ideas that a 10-year-old came up with.
Oh, yeah.
While playing with their action figures.
This was definitely
like in the backyard.
A 10-year-old
and like
action
then
movie.
They just had to take like this handful of ideas a 10-year-old came up with and just somehow worked them to all be in the same movie.
Yeah.
This thing's a fucking mess, man. Double team.
That wasn't without its flaws.
Double team.
Well, we'll say that. We'll say that.
I'm done with ya.
Really?
Yeah.
Double team. More like...
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We got trailers coming up.
Yeah, we're not gonna do this anymore. We're gonna start watching good movies. So let's get a trailer for a great movie we're gonna be talking about next week. And then Double Team enters Judgment Day.
Judgment Day.
MGM UA home video coming attraction.
Can I buy you guys a drink? Guess not.
Patrick Swayze is
Dalton.
I thought you'd be bigger.
Opinions vary.
When he's around, anything can happen.
How's a guy like you end up a bouncer?
Just lucky, I guess.
And usually does.
Somebody gets in your face, I want you to be nice.
Don't be rude.
Ask him to walk, but be nice.
Help this gentleman to the door.
Until it's time to not be nice.
So says the fighting philosopher.
He may be hard to handle.
I keep talking, you're gonna go off thinking I'm a nice guy.
I know you're not a nice guy.
But he's easy to like.
What's the matter, Dalton? Don't you like women?
Worst I ever had was wonderful.
He's not what you'd expect.
I thought you'd be bigger.
But there's one thing you can count on. He's the best friend a good time ever had.
Aren't you guys tired?
Doc, I'll get all the sleep I need when I'm dead.
This
is my town.
I'm not afraid of him.
I guess you'll be having that fire sale now, all right? You got your hands full, kid.
I just think I'm looking at a dead man.
Patrick Swayze.
For that line of work, I thought you'd be bigger.
Gee, I've never heard that before.
Roadhouse.
Caught me.
Caught you what?
Caught me like... in the midst of a burp there. And
caught you slipping. When aren't you in the midst of a burp?
It's
a real shit show editing this podcast.
It's not as bad since
Rick
I've switched
Sanchez
to whiskey.
Persona you've got developed over here, trying to appeal to the young kids. I know what you like out there, kids. You like the Rick and Morty, don't you?
It turns out it's not a persona as much as it's just where my life's taken me.
Okay.
And I'm less...
Some people get gassy.
I'm less Rick in the regular Rick and Morty, and I'm more Rick in the Bushland Adventure, the Australian one I showed you,
deep
where
cut,
it's just
deep
crazy.
Cut Rick and Morty references right here.
Oh, if you kids haven't watched that one, go find
they
it.
Have.
It's on the YouTube. It's uncensored with all the F-words in it. It's the best.
Just like you like. You kids love your expletives.
A lot of people's complained about that episode when it dropped because it was an April Fool's thing, and they were like, people didn't
even
know.
Complaining. Turns out you're the April Fool.
Yeah, it's the best episode ever written of that show.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Thank you. Would you like to take a seat?
Oh, sure.
Cool. You like chicken nuggets, right?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. I got a 20-piece, and I also got two of every kind of sauce. But, you know, if you have a favorite sauce and want more than one packet of it, you can have mine. I like all the sauces equally.
Thanks.
Yeah. Oh, and the nuggets have been sitting out for a little bit because, you know, I didn't know when you'd be here. So just, you know, tell me if they're too cold and I can heat them up in the microwave over there, okay?
Okay.
Yeah. You know what would go great with this?
Hmm.
Some chinoise sauce.
You like Rick and Morty too?
Yes, yes.
Nice.
Yes! Yes, Morty. The chinoise sauce, Morty. We gotta get it, Morty. Come on, Morty, come on.
Oh, jeez.
No,
geez,
Jerry,
Rick,
shut up. Morty, yes.
Rick, I don't know.
Yes, that's yes, so cool. Morty. Keep doing the voice, Morty. Yes, of course. That show's amazing.
Yeah.
Hmm. You are awesome. You're amazing.
Thanks.
You're no problem.
You gotta watch Ozploitation films from the late 70s to get what's going on. Get yourself some culture, kids.
Or you just watch that documentary. I think it's on Shudder right now.
What documentary?
There's a documentary about all the Ozploitation films.
Oh, is there? Well, want to check 70s. That out then. That sounds good to me.
Yeah, it's like almost Hollywood or not quite Hollywood. I don't know.
Got a lot of stuff aimed at my own weird particular interests on that Shudder streaming service. Yeah. God bless them.
Yeah. Check that one out. I've wanted to documentary came out a few years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Dying to want to see it. Never got around to it.
I just like all of their crazy Australian accents. It's funny to listen to them talk.
Oh, absolutely.
He talks so weird.
Absolutely.
Judgment Day. This is, we're entering the Roman Colosseum. The landmine tiger-filled Colosseum where this movie Double Team's got to battle it out for its own survival.
That might have made that Gladiator movie watchable.
We're going to give it a thumbs up or a thumbs down, a la Joaquin Phoenix.
Yeah, I give
Russell Crowe's Gladiator.
I give Gladiator three thumbs downs.
I'll give it a solid three bullets from what I remember
of
my viewing
Gladiator.
Of it in 1999.
I hate that movie.
Maybe the last competent Ridley Scott movie.
I was so bored.
I feel like you didn't get the nuances of Gladiator. You see, the Gladiator was fighting for his survival.
Every once in a while.
Was evil.
Yeah,
because they
talked.
And then he kept having wet dreams about his wife walking through a field, which was poetic.
And they're just like, blah, 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 talk. Love
we're not here to judge Gladiator. We're here to judge Double Team. So, as per usual, I have scoured the internet to find out what people feel like it, what the real people, you people, the salt of the earth people, what you think about Double Team. Do you love it? Do you hate it? It turns out, like with all things, there's a lot of people with a lot of opinions.
I was in LA Confidential.
You could find people that love Double Team. That's how much crazy shit's out there on the internet.
No, that sounds right.
Okay, so I got a couple of one-bullet reviews. I got a couple of five-bullet reviews. We're going to jump into this and see what the larger conversation is around this movie.
Okay.
My first one-bullet review. These are people who did not like this film. Didn't do anything for them. It's from Chris One. He's a Letterboxd user. He writes, when planning this movie, I just imagine a huge pile of cocaine and the three main actors spitballing ideas. After a gram or so, Dennis Rodman decides he would change his hair color in every scene.
A gram or so?
After an eight ball, Jean-Claude decided he would fight a tiger in a field of landmines. Mickey Rourke then decided the tiger should be over an infant that he had stolen from JCVD. This is how all of Hollywood's classics get written.
I want to fight the tiger.
One bullet. So I don't know. It sounded like he was pretty into the movie.
Yeah.
But then one bullet. So
way to puss out at the end. I imagine JCVD went to the studios and said, I want to fight the tiger.
Mm-hmm. He's spot on that there was cocaine going on. I don't know if it was specifically divvied up into grams and eight balls.
I want to fight the tiger.
I don't know how it works out there in the cocaine underground.
Give me your tiger. I want to fight it.
Mr. Roquentin, also from Letterboxd, has another one-bullet review here. Similar theme going on with a lot of these one-bullet reviews. He simply says, so much going on. There are at least three movies here. Tons of action scenes involving babies, tigers getting beaten up, underwater lasers, constant 80-yard basketball jokes. I'm not sure I've ever seen a movie where the creators cared less about sustaining the illusion of the scenes being within any kind of coherent fictional narrative.
Yeah.
This is JCVD and Dennis Rodman just doing cool stuff. And it's impressive that they managed to keep using their character names through to the end. I thought that's a good point.
Yeah.
It seems like they would have just started calling him Rodman by the end of the movie. Like, they're calling him Yaz and he's just not looking, like he can't respond.
Yeah. Hey, Jean-Claude, watch out. Watch out, man.
You can't keep calling me Jean-Claude. This is a movie. We're acting.
Rodman, you got to call me by my name.
But, like I was saying, we're getting these one bullet reviews out of it. Who cares what these people think? The real main event here.
You gave that 1 star?
Yeah.
He sounded happy about
exactly,
it.
Exactly, exactly. This movie is kind of getting a bad rap. I'm coming around on it. And that's why these 5 bullet reviews, I think, are really going to paint the picture.
Yeah, lay it on me. This might sway my vote.
These critics out there, this 11% on Rotten Tomatoes, they're not liking it, but they're not the whole story. Like, you gotta go to the other side. You gotta see what the other side's saying. So this first one is coming from Droog655321 from IMDb. This is a gold mine here, the IMDb. You find all the best opinions.
655321.
You really want to broaden your mind out there. I assume this is just like his throwaway for like looking at porn and doing IMDb reviews. Like, he's probably also got a 655322 that he like uses to email his mom and shit.
I was going to say, let's look that up on Reddit and see how much porn he's posting.
5 bullet review here. He says, this film could have never been bad with these ingredients. An experienced Belgian actor with a penchant for face kicking and poor dancing. A cross-dressing freak of nature, pro basketball player, and Mickey Rourke. Jean-Claude Van Damme plays Family Guy come some kind of agent for some kind of anti-terrorist organization, Jack Quinn. He hates glass a lot. At least 2/3 of this whole film is just awesome shots of him either jumping through or throwing other people through various glass surfaces. Awesome. Something bad happens and he ends up on a stupid island, but no island can hold Jean-Claude Van Damme. He escapes by cutting part of his thumb off. How awesome is that? After he gets off the island, he has to track down the awesomely evil villain Stavros with the help of wacky sidekick Yaz. I won't give too much away because you have to see this film for yourself, really. All I will say is that he kicks a tiger in the face. A freaking tiger. One word. Awesome.
More Marshall Crowe.
So, you know, I can relate to this. There's some awesome things to pull out of this movie. Every once in a while, something fucking awesome happens.
It's true.
Nicola 17 from IMDb is also given this film a 5 bullet review. I'm hoping that Nicola is
Tesla.
There's letting me know that this is maybe like a 17-year-old Russian girl or something. Somebody who
movie was good.
I hope that this person
we love Jean-Claude Van Damme's
doesn't have English as their native language, because if so, there's a lot that needs to be explained here.
Fights kicks are strong.
Okay, 5 bullet review here. Wow, what is wrong with you people? It's called kick-ass action. I can see why people hate this movie so bad. I know it's a bit silly, and I am big fan of Jean-Claude Van Damme and Mickey Rourke, and Dennis Rodman was awesome and funny, but not much as action star, didn't do much of movies, and in this movie it was pretty awesome seeing Van Damme fighting with Rourke, and movie wasn't that bad. Come on, if you're Van Damme fan, you should enjoy this movie. It's fun. Movie, I don't care what people say, and the opening scene when Van Damme driving the big truck in opening scene was cool, and part in of Dennis was funny, but they could have got Wesley Snipes rather than Dennis Rodman, but it doesn't matter. It's still a good idea for me, and Quinn escapes from the colony and goes after Stavros for revenge. Period. Quinn is helped by Yaz Dennis Rodman double team. They helping each another in mission to get his wife and baby in fight scenes with Van and Mickey was awesome. But I know Mickey Rourke doesn't like Van Damme with some reason I don't know about, but the fight scenes was fun. Didn't go for that long, but you don't need to see long as showdown when you Van Damme fights were amazing, like in Bloodsport if you enjoy hard target and double impact and knockoff and kickboxer and Bloodsport. This is fun movie that you will enjoy for Van Damme fans like this only 4.4. I will give this 10.10.
All right, so you're burying the lead. You're burying the lead here. Because I recognize that voice.
Okay.
It's the same exact storytelling as the movie itself. That's the director, Harry Wasayak or whatever his name is.
He's trying to pull a fast one on us.
And clearly, he wanted Wesley Snipes for the picture and not Rodman.
Yeah, a little bit of a disappointment. My original script, when I had envisioned Wesley Snipes for the character of Yaz, it was a lot different. There weren't as many basketball puns in it. There were still some.
If you made it this far into the episode, like, I apologize that you listened to Nate and I fucking sputter about for 45 minutes trying to figure out what the fuck this thing was.
We really got to start watching more coherent movies.
When you could have just read or listened to that review right there.
Yeah, that's two sentences, that review. Sums it all up.
And that's literally what it feels like to watch that movie.
Stream of conscious. Very little punctuation.
Now, I argue, we're going to get to our grades now.
Okay.
And I'm going to say this isn't going to be my highest reviewed of all time.
Okay.
But at the same time, there's a need for these movies.
Ooh.
We can't just be watching all the good ones. Mm-hmm. We got to spray... Mm-hmm. We got to play to all fields.
We really front-loaded it with none of the good ones here in our scheduling.
It seems as if...
you don't know of any other random celebrity birthdays that's going to bite us in the ass sometime down the line later, do you?
Oh, you just wait, pal. You just wait.
Oh, no.
You got to get a couple of these in so that the good has weight of being good.
Yeah. We're laying down a foundation.
At the same time,
shitty movies.
We just switched to action movies, so let's waste a couple shows to get our feet wet.
Okay.
Get our grounding.
I'm feeling pretty soggy.
I don't want to do a fucking rookie effort on a fucking Blown Away Die Hard 3.
I want to be a grizzled old vet of a podcaster by the time I try to tackle. The true masterpieces of the genre.
So there's need to this. We're wading through some things. We're finding stuff out. This is like when you first start dating a girl. And you're like, what if I put my tongue in your butt?
Nope, no, she didn't like that.
You're not ready for that?
No, that did not go well.
Cool. Okay, it's cool. I was just trying some things out. And that's what we're doing here.
What if we watch a Dennis Rodman action? She's not liking this either.
And you're single again.
That was a whirlwind of a relationship.
I still, even though...
You kind of like this movie, don't you? This is what we're building up to
That this movie's terrible because I watched it. And it was terrible.
I watched it like 1.5 times.
And there's no...
Just to make sure I didn't mess up while watching it the first time.
There's no redeeming qualities to it, even ones where I can be like devil's advocate and be like, well, this wasn't bad. No, it was all bad.
Yeah.
It was all bad. JCVD was just collecting a check.
I don't know. His drug dealers were collecting a check.
Well, yeah. I still say Rodman had a winning quality about him.
Wow. On the basketball court and off.
He was having fun. He was having a good time. And he's clearly the only person having a good time here. Mickey Rourke puts in an actual somewhat inspired performance.
I don't mind him as Stavros. It would have been nice to get some more Stavros. We could just get rid of this... one of these different plots and have an actual, he's a bad guy with a plan plot probably would have helped this out a lot.
I'm torn because of how bad this movie is structurally.
Oh, yeah.
We gave...
It's in shambles structurally.
I gave Stop or My Mom Will Shoot 1 star last week, and I feel like I have to give this one 1.5 because it's more action-based.
That's true.
But as we covered, the action's awful.
Terrible action.
And... So much of the movie's bad, but part of it I like is good.
Ooh, air ball.
but I still feel like 1.5 is too much for it.
Okay, wow.
And I think I'm stuck at 1 again.
One bullet. For double team. Ouch. Double team bit the bullet.
Yeah.
On that judgment right there.
It's one bullet, you know, figure out last which one week, of you gets to kill yourself.
Stopper My Mom Will Shoot really didn't do anything for me. But I did give it 1.5 bullets. Because
oh, you did?
I did like Estelle Getty's fiery performance. I thought she was trying. I got as little out of this movie as I did out of Stopper My Mom Will Shoot. But at least Stopper My Mom Will Shoot was coherently shot and edited.
Yes.
If
correct.
Nothing else. So I got to take that half bullet off. I'm also at one bullet.
Yeah.
Strong one bullet.
And I wanted.
For this shit stain of a fucking movie. Yeah. Double team.
Last week.
I'm saying as far as his in theater, theatrically released films, I haven't seen a lot of the straight to DVD ones. Worst JCVD movie right here. I don't think there's any of them worse. I'll take a Street Fighter over this. At least that one's got like.
Raw Julia.
Some so bad it's good, like what the fuck is this I'm watching qualities
quick,
to it.
Change the channel! That's a line that Zangief says in it.
Other than mayhaps some straight to video joints that I'm not aware of, least favorite JCVD movie right here.
Oof.
I'm going on all in. I'm just telling it like it is.
This was a rough one, man. This was a rough one.
We're not going to have to do this because we've gotten control of our
own
schedule.
We're changing the format again?
We're going to start watching some good movies. We've got a lot of good stuff planned coming up. Maybe some more meatier fare that we can dig into, have more shit to chew on rather than just, you know, trying to figure out what the fuck we just watched and pull on the threads until there's no blanket left.
Yeah.
And we got another big celebration coming up. A big 30th birthday next week, man.
Is it my birthday again?
It's not your birthday again, but it's
it'll be 30.
The birthday of a fine film that we all fucking love. It's 30 years ago we all learned how to love while watching Patrick Swayze tear out throats. So, next week we got a powerhouse. We got a heavy hitter coming up. I'm ready for it.
Dirty Dancing.
Mm-hmm.
Now I have the time of my life. No, I never felt like this before. Yes, I swear it's a truth. And I owe it all to you.
Cause I have the time of my life. And I owe it.
Exactly.
Is that the one?
Fucking that rich douchebag knocked up that blonde chick, and Patrick Swayze went right over there and just one quick motion with his fingers just pulled that baby right out of her uterus.
Yeah, ha! Ha!
Yanked it, and then floated the fetus across the lake.
We're just fucking with you. It's Roadhouse, you old so and so.
Hell yeah!
It's the Funker.
First appearance of Sam Elliott on this podcast, I think. This is
maybe
the first time we're getting some Sam Elliott in here.
Is Funker in that one? Funker's in that. No.
Terry Funk, I believe, is in Roadhouse. He's the first person
yeah.
that Dalton fires.
Yeah.
Spoiler alert.
Stan Hansen?
We're not getting into
no,
it
he's
now.
No, it's just a Funker in that one, yeah.
This is all, let's save some content for next week.
Yeah, let's not blow the wad now, you know, like, hey!
Get out there, watch Roadhouse. You've probably seen it a million times, but you can always stand to check it out.
The best
one.
Part is, next week, that's going to give me so much opportunity to do some of my Sam Elliott.
I can't wait. There's a tease right there.
Remember, Nate, stay single, baby oil and blow.
It's a long road when you're on your own, and it hurts when they tear your dreams apart. And every new town just seems to bring you down, trying to find peace of mind can break your heart. Could use a friend.